These are the various gaskets and grommets that make up the Volkswagen 1600 engine building kit. These two we will no longer use because they belong to a 6-volt system. We very seldom see VW with a 6-volt system anymore. For our engine, for all purposes, we're reducing 12 volts. This here is a universal case block off that fits right down here. If you're using a Type 3 case, it has to have this block off. These here, gaskets here, go to the oil stand. This gasket goes between those two and the oil stand right here. These are intake manifold gaskets here for a single port motor. These are intake manifold gaskets for a dual port motor. These are all part of the oil changing kit right here. That's the center plug, drain plug, and these are for the outside six. This little gasket right here goes for the fuel pump. This is the rest of the oil changing kit here. These are all for the face plates for the oil pump. You can notice there's various sizes. Some are for 6mm, some are for 8mm studs. These are all exhaust gaskets right here. These guys right here, there should be 16 of these, are pushrod tube seals for the 8 pushrod tubes. These little O-rings right here seal the inside of the case. We'll put those on very soon. And these guys right here are various oil cooler seals. We will be using these today. The main seal, which does not come with the gasket set, has to be purchased individually and goes into the rear main section. An oil seal. Like so. These are two valve cover gaskets. They go in the valve covers over the head. And this O-ring here goes into the flywheel itself. This last component is for the oil pressure relief units. There should be two in a kit. For some reason, our kit only has one. So we'll have to get another one or reuse an old one in this case.
Always be sure to clean and flush the case thoroughly after it comes back from the machine shop. Use compressed air to blow it out afterwards.
Notice this case has an indentation right here along those six main sealing studs right here. This indentation is for a little black O-ring or whatever color O-ring it may come, white or black in this case. Some cases are flat here. If they are flat, do not put an O-ring in whatsoever. There's no room for the O-ring to crush. I will initially put these in dry, about halfway down. One reason I'm putting these in dry like this is because I don't want oil all over my studs. Okay. The reason I'm doing this is because, first of all, they slip all the way down easier. And also, when I put the second case half on, the oil will cause the O-ring to slip conveniently into the grooves on the second case. Okay. If these do not have oil on or are dry, they might have a tendency to want to pinch the little O-rings here. Okay, these dowel pins should go ahead and just shove easily into these holes right here. There's four on this case half. There's going to be one on the opposite case half. Right there. Okay. There we go. This is an early case. And as you can see on this side, this is the open face of the case right here, we see an extra dowel pin. This dowel pin hole will not be used. Do not, whatever you do, put a dowel pin in this hole. Because at one time, they used to use a split bearing just like they did in the center saddle. This is no longer used. If you put another dowel pin in here, you'll end up crushing this down on the existing bearing. So whatever you do, if you see a 6 dowel pin hole in this saddle, do not use it. These are the 6 cam bearings, 3 for each size, 3 for each side. If you notice, each bearing has a little tab here, and they're often opposite, so only one bearing will fit in each appropriate slot. We'll go ahead and install them right now. There's no tab in this thrust bearing hole, So this is where the thrust bearing will go, right here. Okay. Another. Notice this one here, should I want to show it in the middle one here?
Okay, hold on a second.
Okay. Should I get the pointer out here for that? Do you want a close up of this, something like this?
Yeah, go ahead.
See, here's a tab for this one and this one. The large middle one. Okay, the smaller rear one. Do you notice the holes here line up with their oil holes right here inside the case? Just press them in with your fingers. They should be tight this way. Now we'll go to the other side on the other case half.
Okay.
Before we start assembling anything on this motor, before we put these bearings on the crankshaft, we should mark exactly where they go. There's a reason for this, because once these are mounted in the crankshaft, they're sometimes very difficult to drop into the dowel pin hole. Here, so what I do is put the bearing into the case, lining up the dowel pin hole right here. Okay, here we go. We scribe and mark the bearing on both sides, like so. Now I'm going to take the bearing out.
Again.
We'll use this mark as future reference when we put the crankshaft in. We're lining up the dowel pin hole with the dowel pin.
Yeah.
And we'll place it. Okay. It's got a nice fit to it, not too tight. Now we'll go ahead and scribe it. Head out of the way. Okay. Just like the end of bearing. More difficult to install because of the two thrust halves. So what I normally do is mark a line right by the dowel pin, like so. And there's a reason for this. Should I go ahead and stick it in now?
Yeah.
Okay. You can see the rear and slip it in right here and realize that it bounces right in. I will also scribe and mark the sides like I did in the other bearings. I do this on purpose in order not to pinch any of the bearings. If you were to drop the bearings in with the crankshaft and miss the dowel pin, you'll actually crush the bearing and it will not rotate properly. Okay. Okay. Okay, I screw around my fingers and put a little oil in there. Yeah, pretty much. These are store-bought lifter clips that I frequently use. However, if you can't buy these, a set of a little clothes hanger cut in half and bent over into a big U, like so, works just fine. In fact, for the purpose, we'll go ahead and use these. They'll keep, what they do is they pinch the lifter in there and keep them from falling out when you assemble the motor. We'll set this case half aside for the time being. Again, it's got assembly lube and regular motor oil in it. Okay. Remember the marks we put in here? Now you'll see why we did this. Okay. Okay, before we put the crankshaft in here, I'm going to loop all the lifters and all the bearings. Okay. I lined up the bearings according to our marks. And it goes. Now you have to juggle a little bit. Okay.
Now swivel the line down and then and drop it in there.
Okay. 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 Remember the black lines we put in the bearings? They're for that purpose, to match up. There it goes. Now they're both in. Okay. The far end bearing has a little half moon in it, right here for oil runoff, and that's always exposed halfway, so you know you have that in all the way. Oh, have it in right. Okay. Now, the crank is actually in place.
The dowel pins must line up with the bearing holes when tightening the case halves. The nose bearing on the right came out of a commercially rebuilt engine. The customer ran the engine in this condition and damaged both the crank and the case. One quick way to verify the crank install is to take a half bearing that goes in the other case half and set it over the center main bearing of the crank. If the installed crank is not set fully into the case half, then you will be able to measure this kind of slop in the center main bearing. If the crank is properly installed, the half bearing will completely cover up the center main journal of the crank. The next item to be installed is the camshaft. The cam on the left came out with the later model cases, and it has a recessed face to allow for a bigger oil pump. These numbers on the cam gear refer to the gear pitch, not the diameter, and they run from -7 to +7. Unfortunately, the only foolproof way to tell whether or not you have the correct gear is by dropping it in the case half and testing it.
Here we have the crank timing gear with the two dots lined up with the single dot of the camshaft.
There should be almost no free play between the cam and crank gears, yet the cam must not jump out when the crank is rotated. If it pops out, get another cam.
There it goes. There it goes. See how it pops out? Okay.
And drop it back in.
Yeah.